Penguin Random House Audio presents Change is Good. You Go First. 21 Ways to Inspire Change by Mac Anderson and Tom Feltenstein. Read for you by David H. Lawrence, the 17th. Introduction. Change is not easy, but it is simple. Things will always change. We don't have a choice about that, but we do have a choice for how we react to change, and as leaders, whether or not we create change. The choice really boils down to this: either we manage change, or it will manage us. As a leader, however, deciding to make changes is the easy part. Getting your people on board is much more difficult. Why is that? Quite simply, change is an emotional process. We are all creatures of habit who welcome routine and resist the unknown. Uncharted waters are scary. In the long run, however, sameness is the fast track to mediocrity, and mediocre companies won't survive. Thule Kupferberg said it best: when patterns are broken, new worlds emerge. And that is your challenge, to convince your team that the new world you are trying to create is better than the one you're in. Is it easy? Of course not. It takes planning, commitment, patience, and courage. The truth is that change can be a wonderful gift. It is the key that unlocks the doors to growth and excitement in any organization. And most importantly, without it, your competition will pass you by. As a leader, a big part of your success will be your ability to inspire your team to break out of their comfort zones, to assure them that even though they are on a new path, it's the right path for the right reasons. That's what this audiobook is all about: ideas to inspire, motivate, and encourage your team to move forward and embrace change. Our goal is simple: to help you reach yours. Mac Anderson, founder, Simple Truths and Successories. Tom Feltenstein, CEO, Power Marketing Academy. Chapter 1. Change what needs changing, not what's easy. A few years ago, British Rail had a real fall-off in business. Looking for marketing answers, they went searching for a new ad agency, one that could deliver an ad campaign that would bring their customers back. When the British Rail executives went to the offices of a prominent London ad agency to discuss their needs, they were met by a very rude receptionist who insisted that they wait. Finally, an unkempt person led them to a conference room, a dirty, scruffy room cluttered with plates of stale food. The executives were once again left to wait. A few agency people drifted in and out of the room, basically ignoring the executives, who grew impatient by the minute. When the execs tried to ask what was going on, the agency people brushed them off and went about their work. Eventually, the execs had enough, as they angrily started to get up, completely disgusted with the way they'd been treated. One of the agency executives finally showed up. "Gentlemen," he said, "your treatment here at our agency is not typical of how we treat our clients. In fact, we've gone out of our way to stage this meeting for you. We've behaved this way to point out to you what it's like to be a customer of British Rail. Your real problem isn't your advertising, it's your people. We suggest you let us address your employee attitude problem before we attempt to change your advertising." The British Rail executives were shocked, but the agency got the account. The agency had the remarkable conviction to point out the problem because it knew exactly what needed to change. As Yogi Berra once said, "Before we build a better mousetrap, we need to find out if there are any mice out there." If you don't like change, you're going to like irrelevance a lot less. Tom Feltenstein. Chapter 2. Re-recruit your best people. As the old proverb goes, the journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. Your first step in the change process should be to re-recruit your best people. That, of course, starts with the managers of each department. Although the culture of any company starts at the top, it is the managers who will make it or break it, especially in times of change. Their attitude, commitment, and understanding of the change mission will be key to your success. Don't make the mistake of assuming they're on board, because it can be very costly and disruptive if you guess wrong. Even before the mission is clearly defined, bring them in one-on-one to get their input and their feedback. Get them involved in the planning process, but remember, there will be disagreements regarding your strategy and execution. And of course, that's where leadership comes into play. In other words, if the manager disagrees with the final plan, you need to know up front. At this point, tough decisions must be made. They're either committed to the team's new plan going forward, or you need to find a new manager sooner rather than later. Phase 2 of recruiting your best people will be up to each manager. Once you have mapped out a plan with each manager's input, you must toss the ball to them to have similar conversations with their best people. A rule of thumb is this: out of every 10 employees within a department, there is usually one that will have significant influence over how the others will think. Each manager should identify those individuals and clearly communicate the changes that must be made. They must also explain the benefits to them and to the team. The manager must make these people a part of the change process and depend on each of them to help monitor the team's progress going forward. This investment of your time and of each manager's time will go a long way in helping to ensure your success. You get the best efforts from others not by lighting a fire beneath them, but by building a fire within. Bob Nelson. Chapter 3. Forget for Success. Forget for Success is the title of a book written by Eric Harvey and Steve Ventura. In it, they say, "Our brains are like closets. Over time, they are filled with things we no longer use, things that don't fit. Every once in a while, they need to be cleaned out." How true it is. A big part of the change process is to be able to walk away from outdated beliefs and practices. But as we all know, old habits die hard. In fact, best-selling business author Peter Drucker said, "It's easier for companies to come up with new ideas than to let go of old ones." Harvey and Ventura had this to say about cerebral baggage that weighs us down during change. "Our baggage includes everything from once valid beliefs and practices that have outlived their usefulness to misinformation and misconceptions that we've accepted and even embraced without much examination or thought." Why care about this baggage? Because it negatively impacts us, the people we work with, the environment we work in, and the results we get. Simply stated, whatever we accept and believe determines how we behave, and how we behave determines what we achieve or don't achieve. Regardless of our good intentions, we're all susceptible to flawed thinking that eventually leads to flawed results. But if we dump this data from our memory banks, we free up space for more productive alternatives. We make room for the good stuff, the right stuff. It's easier for companies to come up with new ideas than to let go of old ones. Peter Drucker. Chapter 4. It all starts with belief. At a speech I, Mac, once gave, I was invited to attend the company's awards banquet the evening before. The previous year, the new CEO had thrown out a challenge for all 6 regions. Whoever had the highest percent increase in revenue would get to host next year's annual.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.